Good morning, everyone, and thank you all for being here. In anticipation of a 2020 spring flood, I am issuing a declaration of a state of emergency in Moorhead. This declaration provides an opportunity for the city to seek assistance from the state and federal governments if our flood fighting costs meet the minimum assistance thresholds. To our residents that are new to the area or have not been in this situation before, there is no immediate alarm to our personal safety or immediate harm to personal property. Initiating this action will enable the city to be reimbursed for the cost of expenses utilized to protect public infrastructure. Moorhead is once again prepared for this flood fight. I'm surrounded by City Manager Christina Volkers and her team, which will be our flood command staff response team. Besides City Manager Christina Volkers, we also have as a part of this team, Assistant City Manager Dan Molly, City Emergency Manager Chad Stanglin, Director of Public Works Steve Moore, City Planner Christy Leshofsky, Police Chief Shannon Monroe, and Fire Chief Rich Dyson. This team will guide our community through this event. Also led by City Engineer Dr. Bob Zimmerman, who is the state and regional expert on flood control. Moorhead's flood control staff, or flood command staff rather, is a team that is organized and has been meeting for several weeks. Our staff consists of seasoned flood veterans that have a plethora of experience and know our city and the river extremely well. I would now like to introduce Dr. Bob Zimmerman, our city engineer, for his flood briefing.
Thank you, Mayor. Good morning, everyone. Just a brief presentation to summarize our current preparation efforts for this flood event. This first graph shows the January and February National Weather Service forecasts in the bars, the ones that we've received so far, an additional forecast upcoming later this week. It shows those forecasts relative to the city's permanent levee infrastructure. So that infrastructure was designed for a river stage of 41 feet. The top elevation of those levees is 44 feet. That gap in between, that distance in between 41 and 44 is called freeboard, and that's really our insurance policy against uncertainty. Well, we'd prefer flood stages to stay below 41. We'll obviously take whatever we can get, even encroaching slightly into that freeboard. The good news here is that all of those forecast numbers, even the 5% number, is below the design stage for those levees. The city uses the National Weather Service 50% and 10% forecast numbers as a guide to our flood preparation planning. The numbers shown in this table provide some historical context in that regard. The black text represents the last National Weather Service probabilistic forecast for each of those flood years. 2020 is shown at the bottom. Obviously, that's not the last for this year, but that's the most current forecast. Look at the red numbers in this table indicate the actual crest for those previous years. It's informative to look back historically to see how this year compares to those previous years. And actually, 2001 and 2006 have forecasts that are relatively close to this year's forecast. Interestingly enough, both of those years had flood crests in the that fell in that 10% forecast range. No prognostication there, no forecast there, just a caution that the conditions going into the spring melt and precipitation can drive any range of those forecast numbers, and so we need to be prepared for that full range. This provides a brief summary of the work that the city has completed since 2009 for a couple of key river stages. 38 feet, we use that river stage because below that level, there are very minimal emergency measures that are needed. As well as 41 feet, which is approximately a 2009 flood or potentially a flood of record. So what's shown here are emergency measures needed for those two river stages under two conditions, pre-2009 conditions, before all of the improvements the city invested and state invested in after that flood event, and current conditions. Should note that the pre-2009 conditions do not include the Oakport annexation area, the area that was annexed in 2015. If it did include those, that area, those numbers would be significantly larger. Of note here, sandbag needs for a 38-foot flood, pre-2009 conditions, about 670,000. Those needs under current conditions are zero, and we'll get into a little more detail on that in the next slide. Similarly, for a 41-foot flood pre-2009, about 2.9 million sandbags. The current need for that flood level, even though it's not, repeat, not in the current forecast, significantly reduced to about 54,000. Similar numbers for temporary clay levees in terms of miles and cubic yards of clay needed. So this provides more detail on the current estimate for sandbag needs at various river stages. So the first column represents the actual crest level or river water stage. When we install sandbag levees, we generally try to build those with 2 feet of freeboard. That's indicated as the protection goal in the second column. The sandbag needs for various public infrastructure are in the third column. The fourth column represents about 15 properties on 40th Avenue North that have not yet had an opportunity to complete a voluntary acquisition through the city's flood mitigation program. As in 2019, the City Council has adopted an exception to the city's emergency measures policy for those 15 properties. And so the sandbag needs for those properties are shown in that column. The subtotal column represents the city's needs for this flood event. Again, the 50 and 10% forecast numbers are what we use for planning. The 50% number is roughly 35 feet. The 10% number is 38.5, or to be conservative, 39. So going into this flood event, the city's sandbag goal will be zero. The second to the last column indicates an estimate of sandbag needs for private properties that remain on the riverfront. Per the city's emergency measures policy, the city would only provide resources to those property owners under very specific conditions that are identified in the policy. Should note that we have about 30,000 sandbags in heated storage from last year's flood event. So we have a cushion there in case some of these forecasts change. This slide presents updated estimates for temporary clay levees. Again, very similar. Crest levels, protection goal with 2 feet of freeboard, and then the miles of levees, the cubic yards, and probably more meaningful what that is in terms of truckloads of clay that would be needed. 50% forecast number is 35, so that's not even on the table. The 10% number, approximately 39. And you can see those numbers for temporary clay levees should we get to that stage. In essence, a very, very manageable number. Since 2009, the city has constructed about 12 miles of levees and flood walls, five removable flood closures, 19 stormwater pump stations, and 78 stormwater gates. Combine that infrastructure with any temporary measures that may be needed, as well as road closures that may be needed. Coordinating all of that is a significant effort, and that's guided by the city's flood mitigation plan, or flood protection plan, which includes almost 300 steps. So all of those actions are orchestrated on a daily basis during an active flood event to allow a methodical execution of the city's flood plan. Most of the steps in the city's flood plan go unseen to the public. For the 50% forecast number, which is approximately 35 feet, Our flood team will consider implementation of about 120 of the actions in that flood plan. Some of those will be noticeable to the public, and this is just a short list of those that folks traveling near or living near the riverfront would see. And you'll note that most of those are impacts to the transportation system, road closures, bridge closures, and that sort of activity. The city's website has a wealth of information for the general public. On the front page, there's a link to the to flood information that will take you to subsequent pages that includes a variety of information for property owners. As in past flood events, the city will use a zone concept for fighting this flood event. As part of that, we assign technical staff to certain areas within the city. Within those areas, those folks function as a lead liaison to property owners that are in those areas, and as a technical resource in the field to monitor our implementation of the city's flood emergency plan. These folks are supported by a whole host of technical folks as well as public safety. Also on the city's website is this property mapping tool. It's a GIS application that allows property owners near the riverfront to zoom into their property, look at the extent of flooding under various river stages. It also allows property owners to identify critical elevations for their property in terms of their structure or just their parcel in general. And lastly, just like to note that we will have a public meeting to cover the city's flood preparation efforts. That public meeting is March 12th, this Thursday at 6 p.m. at the Yemcom Center. And with that, I'll turn it back to the mayor.
Thank you, Dr. Bob, for your briefing. And at this time, I will read and then sign the state of emergency declaration. By the powers invested in me as the mayor of the city of Moorhead, Minnesota, I do hereby declare the city of Moorhead to be in a state of emergency for the spring 2020 flood event effective March 9th, 2020. The state of emergency declaration is made to prepare for the flood event and to take appropriate advance measures to protect the city of Moorhead. It is my expectation that the City Council will ratify the emergency declaration tonight at the City Council meeting. Also, if there are residents and businesses that have specific questions about the 2020 flood event, you're more than welcome to attend the community flood response meeting, as Dr. Zimmerman stated, this Thursday, March 12th at 6 p.m. at the Yemcom Center. Everyone is most definitely welcome. And also, as I've been chiming at all the coffee events, for all residents, please sign up for e-notifications where you can get up-to-the-minute updates for any changes or any modifications that might take place during this flood event.